Hi everybody, my name is Vicky Jansen. I work for Tactical Tech, which is an organization that focuses on information for activism. So what we do is we give trainings and create self-learning resources and do investigations around how activists and human rights defenders all over the world can increase their digital security, can limit their data traces, but also can use the data that governments and companies leave to show counter-narratives. So an example is that we give trainings on how to secure your communication. We talk to people about what their mobile means and how they should deal with their mobile phones when they go to protests. But we also highlight specific technical implementations that are used to show how you can sort of flip the tables and use the same sort of profiling techniques governments and companies use on us, but use them on them. If you're interested to learn more, you can go to our website, tacticaltech.org. I work on politics of data, and this grew 5 years ago from our digital security program when we realized that being secure in the current data society for activists and human rights defenders is no longer so about hiding the message, so encrypting your email or encrypting your text message. It is about maneuvering and navigating through the entire data society where we as individuals are being profiled, we're being social graphed, they're looking for key indicators that will tell something about us. So our email might be important, but the apps we use on our phones are just as important. And how can we maneuver this this data society? In 5 years' time, privacy will be the privilege of the elite. I think we're already getting there, but let's assume that we'll be there in 5 years' time. So why I think the statement is quite important is because more and more with that the internet is being into our home. So it's no longer just on our computers, it's already on our mobile phone. Maybe some of you have a smart TV or a smart fridge or maybe a smart car. We're already seeing that the internet's getting more and more integrated into our current reality. And where most of us probably like the convenience of this, it still begs the question why it gives so much information and how that impacts our privacy. So before I continue with the statement, I first want to sort of unpack two things. One is privacy and the other one is elite. At the moment, privacy, in the last few years, privacy has mainly been framed as something that if you have nothing to hide, you also shouldn't worry about your privacy. Privacy is something that only criminals want, and tools to increase your privacy, whether you use them on your computer and your mobile phone, are also only used by criminals. This has been a very dominant narrative in the media, and with recent events, this has only become more dominant. But the question is, are we as a society not asking the wrong question? Because privacy has been something that we've always had, and we're willingly giving it up now, because somebody's telling us that if we want to be private, there must be something wrong with us. Think of we lock our doors at night, we might close the curtains. These are all things you do to remain private in the real world. But yet in the digital world, it's sort of suspicious if you want to stay private. And I think it is actually asking the wrong question, because privacy has something to do about autonomy and about self-control, about being able to make the right decisions and the decisions that work for you without external forces influencing you. And then we go to the elite, because also the elite have changed. If you hear the word elite, you might think about 18th century England, where there's long established families that live in mansions and that have a lot of wealth. And these families are probably still there. But the elite has now also multiplied. There's different types of actors within the elite that have different skills or power to be able to do certain things. So you can, for instance, see that with the rise of the internet, new internet elite have been established. Everybody knows Google and Facebook, and the two founders of Google and Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook, they have for sure capitalized on this. So they're not only powerful because they hold a lot of data, they're also powerful because they have a lot of money. And then there's a third type of elite, which is the elite that actually have the skills to maneuver this data environment. So these are people with highly technical skills who understand what's going on and can also make sound decisions on whether they want to do something or not. And why this is interesting? Because there's a duality in this elite. If you look at the new internet elite, say Facebook and Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook's business model is to destroy all of our privacy. They want to collect as much data about us as possible because this is their business model. And yet, Mark Zuckerberg bought all the houses around his own house so that he could influence who would live near him and because he wanted privacy. So on the one hand, they will go through extreme measures to create privacy for themselves, but the business model that made them rich is actually by destroying the privacy of others. So there's a weird duality in this. So if you're rich, you're allowed to have privacy, and if you're not, you're not. So if you look at companies like Facebook, but also companies that thrive on personal data, you can see that the business model is data. And some of you might already heard the term data is the new oil. And I think this is also, this is partly the story. Part of the story is that data is a way to make money. But the other part of the story is also that data is collected and stored, and it's stored for a really long time. This notion that servers cannot hold data for a long time, so they will delete it after a while, is no longer true. Storage is becoming cheaper, so all the instances where you give up your privacy today will also impact your privacy later on. And why are we so willing to give up our privacy? Maybe this is the most important question. Because if 5 years' time, privacy will be the privileged elite, it means that we're doing something now to enable this to happen. And I think when I look at my work, there's a lot of different factors in it. One is maybe convenience. You're using things your friends are using, so you want to do it. But part of it is also knowledge. Very little people know what's actually happening, how data is collected, even the basics, how the internet infrastructure works, how mobile communication works. And if you don't know, if you think the internet is a cloud instead of that it's hardcore infrastructure, it's very difficult to make right decisions about your privacy. So it's on the one hand convenience, on the other hand knowledge, and it's also skills. How can, if you know what's happening, if you know how much data you give away, how much can you actually control it? Because you give data away at so many points of your life that it becomes very questionable. So when I subscribe for a new service, say a Gmail account or a Facebook account, they ask me for a lot of information. This is registration information. My name, maybe a previous email address where they can verify that I'm not a bot, my phone number, the country I live in, my language. So these are all key points of information about me. And every time I use the service, I of course also give away data. Every time somebody else uses the service and includes me in it, whether they send me an email or tag me on the picture, another part of the data gets added to it. So this is a social graph. My devices give a lot of data away. Location data on a mobile phone gives away so much about your behavioral patterns, about where you live, where you work, who you hang out with, what your favorite bars are. But this is all sort of still in your control, because you can maybe choose to give away your phone or maybe choose to leave your phone at home. The problem actually becomes when, on the basis of this data set, you get clustered into groups and data gets inferred about you. So companies cluster me in a group because maybe I work at Tactical Tech, and in the building where a company is, there's also other NGOs. And on the basis of my location data, they might think I'm left-wing and I work for an NGO, and maybe I'm a left-wing activist who is a vegan. This might not be true, but this could be an assumption they have on the basis of where I work. So this already becomes very difficult to negotiate, because I cannot control what groups or profiles these companies place me in. Plus, I then cannot control what the other data points they add to this, to my profile. So then it becomes more difficult. And I think the other layer why we give it away is because we're given an illusion of control. So by sliders on our phone, by maybe a terms of service we agree to, by these privacy settings on Facebook and Twitter, we actually believe that we can negotiate our data environment. Whereas a lot of these privacy settings are, you can control what other people see, but you cannot control what the company itself sees. So this is illusion of control. So there's a lack of skills and knowledge. And then we're led to believe one thing, while actually something else is happening. And I think the question is, if we don't want privacy to be something for the rich or the elite in 5 years' time, what can we do about it? And do we actually want it? And I think we can already see it. So one of my main concerns is about the centralization of power and money. If you look at Europe, currently we have representative democracies. We can vote every 4 years. Maybe there are multi-party governments or there are different systems. But anyway, they're representatives that the people chose to make decisions about certain things. What we're now seeing in the information age is that there is a centralization of power and knowledge. So it's not only that everybody uses services like Google, it's also that Google has become one of the most important companies in the world. I think they were indexed on a revenue about something like $300 or $400 billion, so they're worth this much. Most people use their email. They have so many services that we don't even realize we're using Google without using it, so they keep on collecting data. They know more about us than we actually know about ourselves, or this is one of their slogans. And with this money, they're making strategic purchases that move beyond sort of the basic internet. They're investing in life sciences, in flying to the moon, in all these things to tackle problems of the future. So they will also become an important player in the future. And why is this important? Why is it so important that the centralization of power should raise questions? Because in the end, Google is still a company that is owned by two guys. And these guys might be nice, but who knows what they have, what they want to do in the future. And this is not a representation of how the centralization of power should be. So this is a way we're already seeing society changing, where the power might no longer be in traditional institutions like governments, but they're more with commercial companies. So also, if you look at internet research that's being done, it's for instance all funded by Google, and it's hardly funded by governments anymore. And then you can question what's the validity of research when it's funded by companies instead of governments. The other thing that's changing, we're already slowly seeing it change, is that there's data and discrimination. Maybe if you have all the things going for you, you're young, you're highly educated, you have a good job, you are not ill, you're white, you come from Western Europe, maybe then a lot of this data will actually play in your favor. You get individual pricing, you will get good pricing, you get good credit rating because you live in a good neighborhood and you have a good education. But a lot of this data is used for predicting the future. Predictive policing, for instance, predictive individual pricing. And there's this need for institutions and people to predict the future and see how we can get the best system to function or the best economic gain. But what if you're not all these indicators? What if you're not highly educated, you live in a good neighborhood, you have a good job, you're not ill? What if you're none of all of these? Then data will impact your life without even knowing it. Because these profiles are curated and then they're used. And how can we have access to them? And this might sound like a utopic or dystopic vision of the future, but we, for instance, already see certain things happening in the US. So researchers found out that on job hunting sites, depending on whether your browser would say you're male or female, you would get a different salary indication. So men actually got a higher salary shown on a browser than if this job website thought you were a woman. And here you can already see how data is being used to discriminate against, even before you register or apply for a job. I think the disadvantages are a few. One is predicting a future. The question is, can you actually predict a future or can you create one? So say I use predictive analytics to do policing, which more and more police forces are doing. Do I actually catch criminals Or do I see a segment in society that I assume to be criminal? And because I look more closer at them, I see more criminal activity. Or do I push them into criminal activity because I already stereotype them in a certain way? And I think with this predicting the future, the question is, in how far are we not driving the future based on our assumptions on the data? I think another disadvantage is as well is that we think all the data that is collected is good. So if we create, if we do predictive policing, for instance, we assume that the data set on which we do this predictive policing is accurate. And I've been talking to some people in the data brokering industry, and I've asked them what they feel about, what they were most surprised about. And 9 out of 10 answered how bad these data sets are, but that nobody questions the data sets in the first place. So we have bad data, we make predictions on bad data, and then we still assume that there's not going to be any sort of bias or discrimination in there. So I think it's going to be really, I think that's going to be a really tough thing to do. And the other tough thing is how I said before about the centralization of power. The power will be centralized by those who hold the data and those who can analyze the data. And analyzing data becomes more and more problematic depending on how big this data set is. And then the advantages might be that we take away most risks out of society, or that we can treat, if we have large enough data sets about certain things in the population, we can actually treat things better in healthcare or other ones. My hint for the future is that I hope that if we come to the point where privacy becomes something for the elite, we finally realize what we've given up. And this is when we start fighting for our right to get our privacy back, no matter what. And my hope is not founded on a utopic belief of what people are. But actually, if I look at different countries where certain basic rights are not there, the right to express your opinion, to right to privacy, for instance, people fight and die for these rights because they really feel it's important. So once we have to start paying for our privacy and feel maybe less comfortable with the fact how our societies are changing, then maybe we're willing to fight for it. So this is my hopeful vision of the future. My worst case scenario is that we all buy into this post-privacy world, that the argumentation that are being used by the internet entrepreneurs that is coming from Silicon Valley into the startup scene about how we live in a post-privacy world, the data is already out there and it's only going to do great things, and people who are concerned about privacy or digital security, they're just old school, they have no idea what's going on, they're destroying businesses, they're destroying healthcare, they're destroying all these things. And my worst case scenario is that we actually start believing this post-privacy argumentation of people who actually make a lot of money making us believe this post-privacy argumentation. Because if I was an internet entrepreneur and my sole business model was data, I would also try to sell us this argument that giving up our data is good, that the world will become better for this data. So that would be my worst case scenario. So I hope that in 5 years' time, privacy will not be something for the elite, that in 5 years' time, privacy is still a common good that is all around the world and all around Europe, and that we actually start fighting this very single and dominant narrative about how giving up your data is good, and how if you're not doing it, you must have something to hide.